Hello friends, I thank Dr. IPS and Dr. Sandeep for inviting to this platform. I'll be talking on arthroscopic transosseous cuff repair. And there is no conflict of interest. I'll be talking under these headings: concepts, biomechanics, technique, comparison, and future. Sutures have passed through the gated tuberosity a century ago. We are just going through the cycle. In next 15 minutes, I will try to convince shoulder surgeons to have this transosseous technique instrumentation set in the shoulder armamentarium. This is a historical perspective. Various people with various design. I'm thankful to Sumant for teaching and the concepts of transosseous technique. These are sleeve, obturator, short drill, TAM, air tunneler, long drill, and suture passer. In 2017, we acquired this instrumentation and did the cadaveric lab. But because of patency issues and for not landing problems, the company has withdrawn those 50 sets from the surgeons, and we are coming with our own design shortly in the future. This is an animation of the original tornea. The middle tunnel is placed where normally we place the middle row anchor. And this has two spring loaded tunnels. One will deliver the retinal loop, and other will hold on to the greater tuberosity. So to the long drill, the intersecting tunnel is made, the previous tunnel to the retinal loop, and loaded suture passer is placed in the retinal loop and pulled out. Now you can place three sutures of your choice. Now it is like a triple loaded anchor is being placed. Now you can go with suture configuration of whichever design and whichever technique you have been using. This is a landmark paper by a father of modern rotator cuff surgery, Stephen Bouchard, in 1997. He said that this technique will fail at the bone interface and anchor will fail at tendon. But in this technique, he made short bony tunnels in the lateral margin of tuberosity. But in present generation of transosseous technique, these are long bony tunnels we play, where the medial row anchor is placed, this is a long bony tunnel. And these both tunnels are in two different planes. I will tell in during the surgery technique, because medial tunnel and lateral tunnel are both in different planes. Different coronal planes. So transosseous technique could not come up at this stage two decades ago. But later, the papers have come showing that this technique is equivalent to the transosseous equivalent repair in terms of fixation strength. And Frederick has shown that with the base Xbox techniques, the transects of bone tunnel group is failure strength is more than the ankle group. There's another landmark paper by Antonio Romeo and Nikhil Verma in 2013. It, using the various suture configurations, he said that load failure at anchor is higher than the transects technique. So transects could not come up in last two decades for three reasons. First thing is technically demanding. And in vitro paper, studies comparisons supporting the transosseous technique. And to some extent, lack of industry support. There's an interesting paper by McMoran, again, showing the transosseous, the failure rate is 578, whereas it trans tunnel group is 468. Here the clinical relevance says there's a type 2 failure in the transosseous equivalent group, the medial tendon disruption. is type 1 failure in process 2. Why it is relevant? Because if there is a type 2 failure, the revision surgery is difficult if there is a tear in biotin insertion. I mean, so technique, first I'll be showing the single tunnel. So this tunnel is made where normally we place a medial row anchor. Normally I use two semi-permanent row arthropods and one permanent fiber wire. These are three simple sutures. Now I'll be showing the crescent shape pair with two transverse tendons. Patient in V shape position, the four panel technique. So intraarticular view, this is the crescent pair. Bicep sternotomy has been done. Minimal subarachnoid decompression soft tissue clearance is being done now. Footprint is being roughened up now. Now first, the anterior tunnel is being placed. This is number two. First, I will show the external picture. Then I will show the internal picture. To avoid confusion, I am showing first external to internal. Is there a repetition? But you will follow. Similarly, posterior tunnel is being made. Number one tunnel. You can see in my diagram. These two tunnels are made in adduction. Now the next lateral tunnel, you can see that my hand position is slight axial rotation. So there are two different planes. Tunnel is made in adduction, and so the big bony bridge and two tunnels in different planes. That's why the construct is higher full strength. So the loop is what? Micro loop from the anterior superior portion. Now I load the three sutures. So this is number two clamp. The sutures are in number two clamp. And I'll take out this other end of sutures, the lateral portal, anterior portal. This is number four clamp. So anterior tunnel is number two and four clamp. Same thing I'm showing the inside view. Now I'm going for posterior tunnel. I don't repeat everything. So this is number one tunnel. So this have clamp on one and three. The other end of sutures are brought and clamp. So I'll mark with my marking pen of these sutures. So number one, three belong to posterior tunnel, two and four belong to anterior tunnel. Now we place a cannula in the lateral portal. Now I release the number one clamp and bring those three sutures to the lateral portal. For this normal post pickup, I use the clever hook. I can use anti-grade or retrograde instrument, whichever you are used to it. Take bites from posterior to anterior, the same color pattern of the sutures we use. I'm using fiber wire in between two arthropods. All these sutures to the posterior portal and I clamp it here. Now I release the number two clamp. It is here, number two clamp. And bring those three sutures again through the cannula. to the inside view. Again, take three bytes in the same pattern. And bring all three switches to the entry portal. So I combine number 2 and number 4 clamp together. You can see these 2 and 4 clamp switches together. These 6 switches. Now I release the number 1 clamp through the entry portal through the ISTOMs. These 2 switches have been brought out entry portal, leaving the last switch which I'm going to tie now. So blue and red has been pulled out, leaving the green switch. Now I'm going to make this green switch. So I'm picking up 2 greens from here and here, from the number 1 and 3 tunnel. The switch are coming, the cuff is made as a post. And now all switches are made a bunch and kept together in anticipatory portal. So you can bring one by one suture. I'll pass sliding suture or a simple suture. Now first the green sutures. Put my pointer here. Knot is coming on the bone. Now I am trying to pull these 2 red sutures to the posterior portal. 2 red sutures. These 2 fiber wires are pulled posteriorly. May make a knot. I want to do an interlinking suture. Now other end of red sutures are pulled out. So this comes interlinking between 2 tunnels. And a temporary clamp here. You can say you know. Okay. I think this is inside view. Same 2 fibers are pulled out. Now you can see that knot, this is only knot on the rotator cuff. Otherwise all knots are on the bone, you can see here. Now I am pulling out 2 blue sutures across this interlinking bead suture. So this blue suture is coming. I am taking these 2 blue sutures and making a knot. This one, and my pointer is in the diagram, this switch will check. Now I have raised the tying the knot of the red sutures. This knot I am tying it on the bone. So we have a non-observable rectangle sutures, this red one. Actually. Now I am planning another green sutures, 2 greens from the anterior tunnel. Now I am going to make this arthrocord come across this interlinking suture. Similarly, last tunnel groove, 2 grooves are picked out and this knot is being made. Now you can see the cuff is evenly compressed tightly to the footprint in the bridging sutures with greater bonding force. You can see it is really compressed. And this is an intra-articular view. You don't see any footprint. This is another short video. Reverse L-shaped tail. I don't go in complete detail. I make a rough on the footprint. 2 tunnels are made. And this is pulling the uppers. And do the small margin convergence. And do repeat the same steps what you have done. And this is again the top. This is a large 3 tendon tail. You can see the supraspinals. emperor's contents and going to Tirusuda. So Trikapta is the present in Sudha Parasiti, a urologist, 52-year-old man. He is going for hunting in a running jeep. The shoulder gun got recoiled. The pest on the shoulder has fallen from the jeep. And here we have to make three tunnels, medially, three tunnels laterally. Three sutures exiting from each tunnel. So to, we have 9 plus 1, 18 sutures we have to manage. This is the anterior one, first tunnel, interlocking suture. The second tunnel, and this is the third tunnel. This doctor started practicing outpatient from 2 months onwards, and 4 months onwards he was operating. So in comparison, it's cheaper compared to PASO's equivalent, but technique-wise, if you use a simple suture, it will be easy, but only all the shoulder surgeons are watching, they are very technically demanding. They can be doing this better suture, but in early part of learning curve, they start single tunnel, and it becomes easy. And there's more biology, more narrow coming from the tunnel. What about retail? Here, if there is a retail, there is a type 1 failure, there is a lateral tendon failure. So, region surgery is easy. Whereas if the retail happens in transverse equivalent, it is type 2 failure. It fails at myotendinous junction. That's a region is different. And you can use same instrumentation when there is a failure with anchors. Without being anchors, if you have this set in the armamentarium, a region surgery is much easier when you have failed cuff surgeries. This is the 36 month slides. We have structural integrity and retail is 80%. So it's almost equivalent. The strength integrity, the both techniques are equivalent. Now this good part of in vivo results of transverse techniques are coming out. You see the Randall's paper, initial post-op pain starting from the second or third week onwards, the post-op pain is less in transverse technique. Iwasaki, a Japanese surgeon, using the contrast enhanced ultrasound, he showed that the sequential vascular pattern in the repaired cuff in the uttermost portion is more in transverse. And regarding the strength, if you remove the retail portion, you compare normally structural integrity healed patients, the strength is more in transverse. Now, I'm talking little bit on type 3 tendon healing. This is a tendon healing classification by Sugaya. You can see here type 1 healing, suction thickness with homogeneous low intensity. Type 2 is suction thickness, partial high intensity. Here, this type 3, insufficient thickness without discontinuity. In his article, he shows that type 1, type 2 is both there, incomparable. The type 3 healing is less in transosseous technique. This type 3 healing is more in suture anchors. And there are a few concerns. As any surgery, the bone tunnel placement and number of tunnels are in the surgeon's hands. But bone quality and the tension is not in surgeon's hands. A lot talked about the bone quality of sutures cutting out. It's more of theoretical this, because we are doing it long tunnels and two different planes, division planes of these two tunnels. So the bone bridges have good strength. And if you see the Kuroda's article in 2013, Japanese study, he has done 384 cases. In that, only one patient had bone tunnel breakage. That too is an old lady. Maybe she is having a lumbar osteoporosis which comes. And in 2016, Suman Christian series, in his publication, out of 133, not a single case of bone tunnel being damaged. And he has not used any bone augmentation device. But J.P. Warner has come with this peak cuff link. We can use this if you suspect any bone cutting or bruises into the tunnel. Or if you don't have, you can do it mini open and put a suture washer. So be prepared for this. And about tight tails, because some cuffs cannot be pulled down. So if you see that the massive tail is stiff and retracted, and if you feel that you are using the advanced lasso loop techniques, or you want to use a biceps augmentation or modulate the fulcrum, if you want to do a modulate the footprint, I don't use this arthroscopic transosseous technique in these cases where you feel that if you don't want to modulate the cuff or lasso loop techniques or depots or biceps augmentation. So this is a follow-up of 30 cases from 2013 to 15 presented in MCSE 2017. Posterior and superior cuff tears, which are amenable to the GT footprint without tension. Subscapularis tears are not taken because I got less experience. I've done only two cases, not of difficulty. Whenever I see the anterior superior tears, I repair subscapularis with anchor. And supraspinatus, I can use whichever technique, anchor or transosseous technique. And we followed the MRI. So these are 26 primary, 4 revision cases. I wrote about when I use a single tunnel, especially patients with past young patients, stiff patients. They do very well. They require very fast. Even in the small lesions, older patients, the cuff is degenerative and bone is sclerotic. Just one time, do the miracle. So out of 20 cases, 7 cases followed for the MRI. There is a type 2 healing. You can see the bridge transosseous. And this is a type 1 healing. So I foresee the transverse technique will come in next decade in a big way, because slowly the good things of transverse techniques coming in the recent publications. Surgeons are becoming technically sound and the surgery is becoming cheap. So take home message is a true transverse is anatomic repair. It is reliable and reproducible, both mini open and arthroscopic, equivalent to current methods, considering the repair integrity and biomechanical strength. There is more biology and more easy in revision cases. Thanks for patient hearing.